Hey everyone, great investing starts with great asset allocation. Great outcomes happen with great advice given over time. Rupert Carlyon is my special guest today, and last week with Rupert we discussed asset allocation, but this week we're diving into the role that advice plays with delivering better outcomes. With Kiwisaver, like any retirement plan, results will vary. And ideally, you want to maximize the amount that you get when it's time to retire. One of the biggest factors in achieving this good number is advice. Research conducted by Financial Advice New Zealand recently found that just over 50% of New Zealanders who get financial advice feel at least reasonably prepared for their retirement. This is contrasted with just over 26% of Kiwis who don't get advice. Now, how we get this advice is a bit of a challenge. I, for one, can only see so many people, and there's the issue of cost. It's not always realistic for people to pay fees for advice. This is where digital advice comes in. And digital advice is great for those who can't access traditional financial advice, and it's actually also pretty good for human financial advisors also. Digital advice will actually enable us to become much more like architects and a lot less like builders. If you like today's show, please subscribe to the NZ Everyday Investor and give us a big old fat like. But before we make a start, I'd like to mention a couple of partners who financially support the NZ Everyday Investor. Kōura Wealth, which is today's guest, is one of them. And another one is Hatch. Hatch makes it easy to get your money to work for you in share markets. If you sign up to Hatch and you set up a new account using the link in the notes and you credit your account with $100, they're going to top it up by $20. So it's a pretty good deal. So having said that, let's make a start on today's show. Hope you enjoy. Welcome to the NZ Everyday Investor. My name is Darcy Ungaro and I'm sitting in the studio with Rupert Carlyon. Welcome, Rupert.
Hi, Darcy.
I'm very good. Thanks for joining me today. Pleasure. And this is the second session that we've had in a wee space of time, so hopefully we're not sick of each other and listeners aren't sick of listening to us. Last time we caught up, we talked about asset allocation.
Yep.
The investor's probably most crucial weapon in their armory in terms of how to approach investing. And today we want to talk about digital advice, which isn't a new topic for the show, but it's something that I think we need to be talking about a lot more for a lot of reasons, right?
Yeah.
Let's start by just defining what it is, but maybe also just defining a little bit about, or talking a little bit about the importance of advice full stop, maybe to start with. And what I'll do is I'll just read this article here. There was a survey that was done, Financial Advice New Zealand's Trust and Advice Report, surveyed 2,000 people, and it showed that just over 50% of advised Kiwis, so people who have received financial advice, just over 50% of them said they were at least reasonably prepared for retirement, compared to only just over 26% of people who haven't received advice. So that's quite a sobering number, isn't it?
Yeah.
And what do you think about that? Like, it's kind of obvious. It makes sense, but
it makes perfect sense to you and I.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it doesn't make sense to far too many people.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, what does advice do? Advice gives you access to information and helps you make complex decisions. And if advice is done well, and if you've got a really good advisor, they'll be able to make the complex simple.
Yeah.
And retirement planning is complex. There's no question on it, right? And KiwiSaver is complex. We all sit there and we tick the box when we start our first job and we think, cool, we are done. To do proper retirement planning, it's all about thinking about how much money do I need for when I retire? Am I on track and am I contributing enough to get enough there?
Yeah.
And then actually, am I invested in the right places to kind of give me the highest chance to get there as well?
Yeah.
So that's quite a complex conversation.
It is, and it's not just about information either.
No.
Like what you just rattled off there, if I was listening to this, I think, cool, I need to do that, and I need to do that, and I need to do that. And that's basically the advice piece. I can do that myself, thanks.
Yeah.
But that actually kind of defeats the purpose. We're talking about something external to you.
Exactly.
Which says it, and that's probably a key distinction between advice and information, right?
Yes, but I would argue advice has got two roles.
Okay.
Advice is to ask you those questions.
Yeah.
And I might have rattled that off, but fundamentally, that's probably the first time a lot of these listeners would have thought about it in such basic terms.
Yeah.
So advice is asking the right set of questions. Advice is also then providing relevant, easy to understand information that is tailored to your own situation. Advice done well is all about simplifying complexity. And I think it's about asking the right questions and delivering an answer that resonates with the person that is asking for that piece of advice. Yeah. And so that's why your stats don't surprise me.
Yeah.
Retirement is complex. There is a lot to think about. But fundamentally, you can actually simplify it. And if you boil it down to a few simple questions, how much do I need? How much do I need to contribute to get to what I need? And how do I invest it to get there?
Yeah.
All of a sudden, it's manageable. That might seem like a simple process from your advisor, but actually, it's a skilled advisor that has managed to simplify it down to that.
Yeah.
And then guiding you through the answers to those three or four questions.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, you've taken a mind that you just have put off into the back of your mind because you've thought, I don't even know where to start.
Way too complex. I'm just going to shy away from it. Yeah.
To go, actually, now I get it. And so I wouldn't even be surprised in that answer.
Yeah.
There will be people that the advisors talk to. They don't necessarily get them to change anything.
Yeah.
But they go, well, actually, but the clients walked away from with a whole lot more confidence saying, at least I now know where I stand.
Correct. And that's, I've seen that so many, especially this year.
Yeah.
You know, not necessarily making any changes or recommending any changes, but having conversation with people, it's like what you're doing is you're taking a subset of all of the answers out there and you're distilling it into a smaller set and then asking questions to match those things together, right? And that's kind of like, I go so far as to say that when it's a human advisor, there's also a creative element which draws upon things which aren't necessarily
that's true.
That's another distinction, right? But if we just think about it in terms of information versus advice, there is that kind of filtration process that happens, isn't it?
So we did a survey last year, which was really interesting, where we asked people where they went to for financial advice and where they went to for KiwiSaver advice in particular. And what was interesting is 50% said their primary advice source was Google.
And
on the very first search page on Google, when you ask a question, you're going to get 6 contradictory answers.
Yeah.
So that was kind of concerning, right? Then the second place was a bank. Banks are pretty adamant that they don't give KiwiSaver advice. You can book an advice session, but not many people do that. But they think that the branch teller is the person to give advice from.
Yeah.
And fundamentally, there are very few places now that people go and get access to advice. And if you don't get quality advice, often it's confusing and it's contradictory, which is why you get those stats, right?
It makes sense. The problem that, you know, anybody in the financial advice community is trying to solve, it's basically helping Kiwis make more informed decisions that are tailored for their circumstances so that they can get a better outcome in retirement. That's kind of like the whole thing. But I guess the challenge is, how do you reach these people in an efficient, scalable way and create an impact? Because that's the challenge, right? That's where the rubber hits the road.
And welcome to digital advice.
Good little foray into that, isn't it? Good little segue, rather. So tell me about that. Because the problem is that Kiwis, it's just difficult for the people who want to give it and the people who want to receive it. It's difficult for that to happen because usually there's a human, been a human there. So what is digital advice? So
digital advice is when a computer or a website will ask you some questions to understand your objectives, understand your risk tolerance, so that they can then try and help you answer some of these questions. So our digital advisor at Kōura is set up entirely for KiwiSaver. So we work to understand your contributions. We ask how much you're making, how much you're contributing to your KiwiSaver current balance. We understand what you want to use your KiwiSaver for. And then we try and ask some questions to understand your risk tolerance. And so what that does is that allows us to give you a piece of advice which will say, are you on track for the retirement that you expect? And the biggest piece of feedback we get from people is that's the biggest surprise of all when we tell them what their forecast is like.
Actually, can I pause you there? Because I recently had a couple of sessions with a client of mine who did move on over to Kōura.
And
I was just reading an email from him this morning, actually. So this is actually happening right now. But he said to me that he loved the part of the process where effectively it was just explained to him in plain English that he's going to have X amount per week.
Yeah.
And that's actually what he wanted to know. He didn't know initially that that's what he wanted to know, but that's what he wanted to know.
understanding whether you're going to have $1 million or $2 million is kind of pointless. What you need to know is, today I've got $1,000 a week to spend. How much am I going to have when it comes into my retirement?
That's right. So what does it mean, right? What does a number, but what does it actually mean for me?
What does it mean?
Yeah.
And so for us, the digital advisor is telling them what they're going to get, what that means for them, and then how to invest it. So the three basic retirement problems we're trying to solve, admittedly we're only doing it on a KiwiSaver perspective, but it's actually about giving people a framework in which they can think about it.
Yeah.
And so that is a typical digital advisor of saying, hey, you've told us about you and we're giving you some outputs that relate entirely to you and to your situation, including some recommendations. This is nothing new, right? In New Zealand, I would argue we're the only people really kind of taking it that far.
Is that right?
There is one other digital advisor in the market, but they're not doing risk tolerance assessments, which to me is the most important part of KiwiSaver and advice. But what we're doing is following an international, tried and tested international model, where there are a lot of digital advisors that have come out in the US and particularly in Hong Kong. There's a few starting in Europe as well.
Yeah.
And the reason internationally these guys have become quite successful and very popular is people are pretty reticent to pay for financial advice in this market. And particularly if you've got a small KiwiSaver balance, if you've got, say, a $10,000 or $20,000 KiwiSaver balance, you don't want to pay your advisor $500 to kind of spend a couple of hours with you to help you to sort it out, right?
Yeah.
And because the advisors still need to get paid, they're spending time, they're doing a good job, there's a little bit of a hard piece here where you go, actually, how do we give financial advice to people with small balances and people that can't afford to pay for it?
That's right.
And the only way to do that is digitally. And so what we can do is by spending a huge amount up front and the infrastructure to set it all up, it means we have a variable cost of close to zero for every piece of advice that
so
we deliver.
So each incremental... where each new client you bring on, there's no additional
cost. Yeah, or everyone that we give advice to. Correct. So under the traditional in-person model where someone's going to spend a couple of hours with every single client and that's got a significant cost attached to it, we can make sure it all happens digitally.
Got it.
And so what that means for us is we are hoping digital advice gives a whole new world of people access to advice that they would not have previously had.
Right.
Which then enables them to make some better financial decisions.
Sure. And we're seeing this across, it's not just in the area of KiwiSaver or even in the area of investments, but we're seeing, increasingly we're seeing how technology is not just a cool little nice to have little gadget. It's starting to become something that we trust more. And you know, before we were recording, we were talking about self-driving Teslas, right? And after a while, you can actually trust these things. And it's a bit scary because every now and then they don't trust themselves to the extent that you do and they let you down. But there is this progression and I guess this evolution that's occurring where, and I know I'm drawing quite a tenuous sort of parallel here, but when it comes to financial advice and digital advice in that realm, there will be this kind of leaning in on it eventually, right? Like we'll start to trust it a lot more. And it will start to become, I guess, more trustworthy as well because it'll become so much more capable.
It's a little bit like, I see it a little bit like credit cards, right? And internet. Remember 10, 15 years ago, there was no way you're putting a credit card in your internet.
That's true.
The internet.
That's true. I thought that was a bad thing to do, but now it's okay. I don't know what
happened. Because you're like, it's going to get stolen, someone's going to spam me, it's going to end up in some ration hacker's account somewhere, and I've just lost it all.
Yeah.
In my view, particularly in New Zealand, digital advice is one of those things where people go, well, it's actually not the personal experience that I'm used to, and it's not the personal experience that everyone talks about, so therefore it's not real advice.
Right.
But if you think about the conversation that you would have with an advisor and the outputs that you get from them, I accept we can't give the personal touch and we can't give some of the humanistic factors that do make personal advice really, really important.
Not yet, Rupert. That's coming.
Well, there is someone, we are talking to someone about whether we can do that, but I'm a bit, I can't quite decide whether people would find it scary to have it delivered by face or not.
Oh, you can use my face.
True.
New Zealand's most trusted source of financial advice? No.
But
you've got a long way to go there,
I think. Yeah, well, no. You came up top of the list on Money Hub's most trusted podcast yesterday.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, thanks, Money Hub. Well done.
So, no, you're definitely
cool. Checks in the
advisor.
Mail, Money Hub. No, I'm just kidding. There's no money changing hands.
So that's why I think there is people aren't used to it. People need to spend time getting there. But also people with their KiwiSaver in particular need to spend more time to understand that it is actually a complex product.
Okay. But going back though to the people don't trust it yet, tell me more about that.
Well, they don't see the it's
they don't
they
see that
trust
it's actually
it, but they don't I think people are struggling to see the value in the advice.
Interesting,
because so we get feedback saying, oh yeah, that's all really nice, but who cares?
So this is, I guess, a classic case, though, of when you know, as the person on that this side of it, you know what you're doing is awesome. It's technically brilliant. It's so far, so much better than everything else in the market, and it could reach a lot of people and change a lot of people's lives for the better, all that sort of stuff. You know that, but it's like sometimes it doesn't matter how awesome something is if people just don't get it, or people don't realize what it is yet. Like, do you find that there's a bit of a journey that's going on?
Yeah, there is a bit of a journey, and we clearly need to do a better journey on our side as well.
Right. Okay.
Because it's always our fault. It's never the consumer's fault. Yeah. The thing is, how do we get people to understand that the product we are selling is a very complex product?
Right.
A little bit like the example of thinking about retirement. Fundamentally, it comes down to those three or four questions.
Yeah.
And we've made it so simple for people that people go, oh, well, that's just too simple.
Gotcha. And they assume that the whole thing is simple.
Yeah. Well, I think there's, I'm not, maybe. But we kind of, that's part of the hard piece about it. But I think.
You are trying to simplify a really complex topic. But when you reverse engineer it, you assume that it's a simple topic because someone has made it simple for you.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what makes it really hard.
Interesting.
Because, and what we need people to understand is that fundamentally, people need the evidence shows people need advice and people need help on this. New Zealand, we got less than half the people sitting in the right KiwiSaver funds. We've still got 500,000 people sitting in default funds.
Right.
There is a massive, massive spectrum of people in New Zealand that have never asked the question on their KiwiSaver, and even if they did, they're not sure who to ask the question to.
Of course,
That's what we wanted to build a product for, because in the US, that is what this product has been amazing for. It's been about saying there is such a massive group of people that want to invest, but don't really know how. They might only have $5,000 or $10,000 or $500. So the traditional financial advice world is completely closed off to them.
Yeah.
And this is a way of getting those people in. And the beauty about digital advice is that it's binary, right? It's a computer.
Yeah.
The computer says one or the computer says zero.
Yeah.
There is no gray.
That's right. It's rules based.
It's all rules based.
It's not going to come down to if they were drinking the night before.
Yeah.
And they come up with a really terrible answer.
It's really simple. You go, fundamentally, we believe good investment is all about good asset allocation.
Yeah.
And because we've got great asset allocation models hardwired into our programs, that means that every single client always gets the benefit of that.
Yeah.
We're not reliant on someone changing them or saying that. It's just a great way to deliver consistent advice.
Gets rid of
everyone.
All the timing issues, all the sort of conflict of interest. Well, they don't exist. So I guess so from a regulatory point of view, it's great because I guess a regulator like the FMA could have a look at that and say, well, that's actually just a set of rules.
Oh, completely.
It's not going to be shifting around. So it's arguably a bit more trustworthy, right?
Oh, it is. And it never changes. And we're fully auditable. And it's so that's why the regulator actually loves it. Because it's the cleanest way of following through and checking exactly what's happening.
Got it. So like if anything, like if we were to be critical a little bit on, say, digital advice in respect to KiwiSaver with what you're doing, I guess the only criticism is that potentially it's too soon.
Yeah.
Would you agree with that?
I think it is, but with balances where they are. Well, unfortunately, too many people think of KiwiSaver as a bank account.
Right.
And so they sit there and go, it doesn't really matter who I'm with. I can't touch the money till I'm 65. I either need to chuck it in a growth fund or a balance fund, and how much mortgage there to think about.
Yeah.
And we haven't yet got a maturity yet where people are kind of willing to think, a bit more complex than that. So,
But I think that's why I say if anything is too early, because I do think people are shifting. Like, I think there is this.
It is.
You know, the financial literacy, either I'm misled because I'm in it and I can't see from another perspective, but it feels like people are just becoming a little bit more aware.
Right? They are, though I think we still need to remember. So there's 3 million people signed up to KiwiSaver.
Yeah.
Such a big number, right?
Yeah.
But in saying that, there are about 150,000 people that switch every year. So less than 5% of people actually switch.
Right.
So then you go, there might be another 5% going that are actually thinking about it but can't quite get enough the information to do it.
Yeah.
So based on the research and the numbers that we do, of that 3 million, we think there's probably only 300 or 400 that are actually thinking about their KiwiSaver.
Right. Is that right?
On an
300 or 400,000 that have actually decided to be purposefully.
They might have decided in the past, but they haven't thought about it for a long time.
Sure.
Because
the whole industry is kind of still set up to be.
To be simple.
Yeah, and to be profiting off of people's inertia.
Yeah.
Right? And so there's this fine balance. You want them to review it. Right, but at the same time, you don't want them to be kind of chopping and changing all the time. Like, and then when we see what happens in March, where they swap it into a conservative fund right when the market tanks, so you kind of want them to be engaged, but engaged in the right way, not engaged in the view of thinking about it from a timing point of view, but engaged thinking about it from an asset allocation point of view, right?
Yeah, and so we want them properly engaged, and I think our model. So I worked in a lot of other financial organizations. And it's also one of the fundamental differences, right? Where we go, it's all about engaging with your customers, getting them to understand what they're doing, giving them, because you're really proud of your product and you want to get them to experience the product as much as you can.
Yeah.
Whereas the traditional financial services approach is sign them up, talk to them as little as you can so they forget that you exist.
Yeah.
And it's just a slightly different way.
It's pretty harsh. But it's true.
I think it's changing.
Yeah.
But I mean, where you go, if you've got a current account sitting with someone, they don't actually want you to think about that.
Mm.
They don't want you to think about the fees that come out of the credit card. They don't want you to think about. And it's about engaging a lot more, I think, with customers, which is what tools like this allow you to do.
Yeah.
March for us was a really good test of our model.
Right. Okay.
It's nice to have a market crash and a global pandemic 4 months after you launch a business. but we found that we had one customer switch funds into a conservative set of options.
That's pretty awesome.
With the rest of the market at 10%.
And you would attribute that to the way that you funnel them into the digital advice tool.
Exactly.
So they're actually getting.
We take a lot of that down to the digital advice tool because we know we had people. In the right set of funds for them. We know we didn't have home buyers sitting in growth funds.
Yeah.
Anyone that was retirement was sitting in the right fund for them.
Correct.
We'd ask them the question. So if they told us that they were going to react or we thought they might react badly in a market downturn, we'd put them in conservative options.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of thing that the digital advice tools allow us to do.
Correct.
Which allows us to make sure that people sit in that right set of funds for them,
which is good, and it makes sense. Like, if I was to draw a parallel between, you know, how digital advice can help a KiwiSaver provider match their solution correctly to the user, I think about this in the context of insurance. So, you know, life insurance, for example.
Yep.
So, for me, if I was talking to a client of mine and we were talking about life insurance, I lean quite heavily now on digital advice tools that the product providers now provide to come up with my recommendation. It's all just based on rules, and those rules are there to create answers to somebody's situation. And so my role now becomes far more important because I'm moving up that value chain.
Oh, completely.
And I'm giving them more guidance. I'm the architect, not the builder. And that's really important, I think, in this, is that technology is here to push us all up. And it works better in some areas than others, but that's basically all that's happening.
That is what's happening with digital advice.
Yeah.
It is allowing you to focus on, because let's be honest, a person is coming to see you. They want to make sure, so the base expectation is when a client comes to see you that they deliver, that you deliver a great quality advice that looks out for your clients.
Yeah.
And what technology enables us to do is actually make that just the standard.
Yeah.
And there's no debating that, right? Because you go, look, you know what, the technology is now at a spot where I'm giving great life insurance advice, or I'm giving great advice here, and then it allows you to focus on the conversation.
Correct.
Which is what the clients want out of you.
Correct. And to be honest, like that conversation that they want out of you, that's a moving, well, that's not a moving piece, but it feels sometimes like the people in the financial advice community don't necessarily appreciate just what component of what you're delivering as an advisor. They don't really appreciate what component actually genuinely adds value to that person.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes the consumers don't really fully get what that advisor is there to do either until they have an encounter. And then they realize, wow, that was amazing. I'd never considered all these things.
Yeah.
And now somebody's just put it into context. That's just amazing. I thought they were there to tell me which stocks to invest in.
No.
You know,
it's fundamentally the role of an advisor.
Yeah.
Making the complex simple and giving good quality relevant information to their situation.
Yeah.
And that's what we can do as a digital.
Yeah.
What we can't really do is what you guys can do is we can't hold their hand.
Literally.
And
yeah.
Literally holding a client's hand is often the most important role that you guys will have.
Yeah.
And that's actually where these products have gone in the US.
Right.
Is what they're doing is they're saying, well, let's give the digital advice tools to the advisors, because exactly the same as what you say is happening here with the life insurance industry,
yeah.
Where you go, a lot of the value sits in the IP and in that world of the tools to make sure we get great investment outcomes. Yeah. But we know there is a really important role for the handholding, yeah. And let's allow people to focus on that.
Yeah, and indirectly, we've kind of answered a question that I didn't even ask you, which is, you know, is there still a place for physical advisors? And I was talking to a couple of guys yesterday who were looking to get into the industry to be investment advisors, and they wanted to know, you know, is it a viable business for us to be studying to get involved in when technology seems to be moving in more, almost, which is a thought that I've had as well numerous times, you know, is it something that's going to displace what we do or enhance what we do?
Oh, it's definitely enhanced, right? Because the role of an advisor is fundamentally the role of an advisor is asset allocation.
Yeah.
And some advisors, you might try and be hedge funds, but those advisors don't generally last that long.
Yeah.
The role of an advisor is to build great balanced portfolios matching the risk appetite of your clients.
Mm.
Yeah. And that will never change. And my view is that the digital will do that for you, but there will always be a role for people to talk it through. And actually, from a client's perspective, that means that they will get a more consistent service, so they're going to focus on all of the soft things, which is actually what an advisor should also be focusing on as well, right? And it's a little bit like March, a 40% downturn, 30% downturn in the market. They want to ring you up and they just want a solid piece of advice. They just want a solid piece of advice going, what should I do here? Should I do anything? What's going to happen?
Yeah.
They don't want a new plan. They don't want all the detailed stuff, but that's what they want out of you.
Yeah.
And I think that will never change.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I agree. It'll just be enhanced.
But then the problem that we have, the $20,000 KiwiSaver balance, which is actually for that person, that is their entire life savings.
Mm.
Are they going to be the ones that are willing to pay $200, $300, $400, $500 a year for you to answer those phone calls and do that stuff? Are you to build you the asset allocation that you need?
Yeah,
that's the issue.
That's right.
And that's what we need digital advice to solve.
Yeah.
Because what we know is that making the wrong decisions with your KiwiSaver can be really, really, really expensive.
Yeah, and those decisions, costly mistakes, can magnify over time.
Exactly.
Right? Like putting yourself in a default fund for 30 years.
And someone earning $80,000 a year, you're sitting there, you're one of the 400,000 people that have never moved out of a default fund.
Mm.
By the time you get to 65, that's going to cost you $200,000 or $300,000.
Yeah.
That is huge.
Yeah, and that's it's sad because it basically means that people who can't afford to pay for personalized financial advice, analog financial advice, they get poorer outcomes, and therefore they get separated further from those who can pay for higher quality advice, who get better outcomes.
Exactly. Yeah. And it just perpetuates. And so that's what we are trying to do in saying, look, whether you're $500, $1,000, $100,000, we can guarantee you're going to get the same investment outcome.
Yeah.
Because you're going to get exactly the same piece of advice, and you're going to have the exact same ability to put things together in the same way.
And maybe even better right now. Like maybe even right now, there are people who are, $300,000 or $400,000 KiwiSaver balances, and that's with their bank, and they've never actually had any advice at all.
Oh, completely.
Yeah, those with $10,000 or $20,000 could jump on the website right now and get higher quality advice potentially, right?
So what shocks us when we look at it is who a lot of our transfers come from.
Right.
And particularly some of the larger balances.
Right.
And you look at the performance of the funds, you look at the type of fund they come from, and it does, you're 200% dead right.
Right.
It's probably equally likely that the $10,000 balance has thought really hard about it as the $200,000 balance.
Interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Phenomenal. So talk me through this then. So if someone's listening and they want to actually sample this.
Yeah.
Is it possible for them to sample without committing?
Of course. Yeah. So we have built our digital advice tools that anyone is welcome to come and use. Yeah. They're available on the Kōura website,
which is
kourawealth.co.nz.
Cool.
You'll generate a portfolio. You can take that away and compare that to what you're expecting from your current provider, or what the asset allocation is with your current provider. So you can go away and do some comparison if you want.
Yeah.
Or if you want to simply, if you want a investment scheme that's low fees, very high ESG, plus an investment style that has proven to make you more, then just keep on clicking through and sign up to Kōura.
Cool. So ESG, environmental, social, good governance, if you want that, if you believe in passive investing, and you understand the benefits, and by the way, it's actually pretty affordable, and you get higher quality advice, which is consistent.
And then the beauty about, one of the things that we are trying to break is this whole perception that KiwiSaver is set and forget.
Okay.
And so you will get this advice today, and whenever you want, you can go and reuse the tools and make a quick switch to your portfolio.
Right.
But we will also come out proactively to you and engage with you every year, at least annually, to say, hey, look, so we're going to say, Darcy, hey, have you thought about your KiwiSaver for a while? Yeah. Just remember, this is what you've told us. This is what your KiwiSaver is going to give you.
Right.
This is where your KiwiSaver is currently invested.
Right.
But because you've changed a little bit, we think you should change it to here.
Is that right? So someone can log in and they use the tools to set their fund up, say, 2 years ago.
Yep.
And they left it a little bit too long, but they jump back in and they review it. It will automatically pull, what they
It'll
have.
Pull all of their information to kind of give them updated. And even if you don't want to go into the system.
Yeah.
We're going to come out to you proactively.
Yeah.
So we'll be sending you emails because we think not setting and forgetting is the right thing to do, and we'll make sure we'll do our best to engage with you to make sure that you are making those decisions on the way through as well. So we'll proactively do all of that stuff because fundamentally your KiwiSaver is your retirement and we want to help you make the best decisions today and also the best decisions all the way through to your retirement.
Makes sense. Just quickly before we finish up, fees.
Yep.
Can you give me a clue as to what the fees are?
Yep.
And because I'm just thinking, right, let's say I was with one of the major banks and I was paying 1.35%, for example.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, right, well, apart from being set up this plan when I walked in to set up an overdraft for my kid, no one's ever really talked to me about this. And I understand and I appreciate the importance of advice and asset allocation.
Yeah.
I want to consider doing this, but I don't want to do something if it's going to be more expensive. So
that's really fair, right? And when we set up Kōura, we were adamant that we wanted to create a fund and an attractive scheme on its own right. And so for us, our fees at 0.63% plus $30 a year annual charge.
Okay.
That's one of the lowest in the market.
Yeah.
So very, very low fees. The average growth fund fee is closer to 1.3%.
Yeah.
So less than half of that. Yeah. I think, and then if you look at other schemes who allow and facilitate advisors, the average fee would be closer to 1.4%, 1.5%. So this is a very, very low cost option. And just to remember that every dollar in fees that you pay is a dollar less in returns in your account.
Yeah.
So fees are really, really important. They're not everything.
Yeah.
Getting advice, asset allocation, service, you do need to think about more than just fees when you're thinking about your KiwiSaver, but it is extremely important.
Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, so www.kurawealth.co.nz if people want to check that out, and I'll put a link in the show notes, of course. And you are a partner of the ANZ Everyday Investor, so thank you for that as well.
Pleasure.
And we'll no doubt have you on the show again shortly, but thank you for the last session as well as this one. Appreciate that, and we'll leave it there.
Thanks for having me, and great to be part of this as always.
Awesome. All right, thanks, Rupert. Take care.
Cool.
Cheers. Thanks.